Therefore, we gradually evolved some basic labor policies, which are very simple in statement. Indeed, they are commonplace, except in execution. Here they are. 1. Provide the best possible working conditions. 2. Try to pay a somewhat higher wage than anyone else pays. 3. Provide rewards and facilities over and above what any other company provides. 4. Insist that foremen treat their men as human beings. 5. Avoid the strict definition of the duties of any supervisor or foreman in order that no man may easily pass the buck. These are the principles we have observed from the time when we found it necessary to have principles. They seem to be right. But expanding at the rate we did, we could not hope to have the old employees put the ideas and the ideals of the company into the newcomers. There were too many of them. And so, in 1910, we began to make the labor side of the business a major affair. I was brought up as a salesman. I think that I still am a salesman. Perhaps that is the reason why I know enough about selling to realize how easy it is to overdevelop the sales side of any business. To put money into sales expense that ought to be either in the quality of the product or taken off the price to the consumer. There is a great waste in selling, and especially in hurrah selling, with conventions, campaigns, contests, and all the odds and ends of high-pressure stuff that have been devised. I have tried all of it, and I know. The place to start selling is in the factory, and if the articles we make are not good enough consistently to be sold to the public without any hypnotic processes, then they are not good enough to sell at all. There are times when extra sales pressure is useful, say to clear out big inventories. But I should never think of putting on a sales campaign just to stimulate the salesmen. If the salesmen are not doing their work, then that is the fault either of their managers or of the product, or of both. The fundamental faults of management and manufacturing are only made the worse by giving artificial sales aid to the distributors or by shifting the blame for bad conditions to them. Our business cannot afford to go ahead in a series of sales spurts. It makes manufacturing too expensive. The kind of selling that really helps in the long run is the steady sort that turns in orders week in and week out in a gradually increasing volume. And so all our efforts today are in the direction of steadiness. We want our sales to increase year by year somewhat faster than the increase in the registration of motor cars. That, we have found, is the cheapest and most profitable way to do business. It does not pay to try to get the business all at once. In the first place, you can't get it, so a good deal of your money is thrown away. In the second place, if you did get it, the factory could not handle it. And in the third place, if you did get it, you could not hold it. A company that gets business too quickly acts just about as a boy does who gets money too quickly. Automobile tires are today a commodity, even more so than leather shoes, for although there are fashions in tires, these fashions are not now fantastic. A passenger automobile is a utility as much as a truck, and no one wants a tire just for looks. A tire has to be sold for what it will do, and no amount of enthusiasm in the sales force will make up for bad manufacturing. So the way to advertise and sell tires is, to my way of thinking, the way to sell any commodity, that is, on service to the buyer. The job of the salesman is to find out the exact requirements of the prospect and sell to him the tire that will best fulfill those requirements. And the way to make the sale is to know tires so thoroughly that you can explain to the prospect just why you can give him a brimming dollar's worth of service. No frills are necessary in this kind of selling, and consequently, no frills are necessary in the advertising, dealers' helps, and so on, that are designed to make the selling easier. Selling is first a matter of having something to sell, then of finding whom to sell to, and finally, of finding real reasons why this prospect should buy. But it took us some time to find out that frills in selling are only an added expense. We were all right in the beginning. We did not have money enough to do other than sell. But then later, as we grew and began to make money, we went in for more elaborate methods until eventually the methods got the better of the selling. Then I called a halt on it all, chucked the methods, and went back to first principles. This is a record of a number of mistakes. We learned a lot from them. So may someone else. We are wholesalers. Our business has always been divided into the two broad classes of manufacturers' sales and trade sales, the first being to the manufacturers of vehicles who sell our tires as part of their original equipment, and the second to distributors and dealers. We have never sold automobile tires directly to the consumer and have no intention of going into the retail business. For a large business such as ours, the matter of retailing would add too many complications. The individual independent dealer will always fill a necessary need and have an important place in the distribution system of a national manufacturer. In our early days of solid tires, we sold directly to retailers, mostly to carriage dealers and wheelwrights. As our business became larger and worked gradually over into automobile tires, we began to establish distributors, giving to each distributor an exclusive territory. A deal is to be said both for and against giving exclusive territory, and I do not believe that the question can be decided abstractly. It gets down to cases. The advantage of exclusive territory is that whoever has the territory may be held responsible for the sales, or the lack of them. The disadvantage is that the manufacturer is tied down in his sales by the ability and ambition of the man who has the territory. In an ideal business world, one would give exclusive territory to the man best fitted for that territory. But unfortunately, things do not work out so neatly. Almost everyone sees that it pays to sell a lot of goods, but not nearly so many see that no one sells a lot of goods who does not work hard. And hard work is, unfortunately, not a universal habit. A small concern with insufficient capital must depend on jobbers for distribution, and there is really no better way to distribute if the jobbers know their business. It relieves the manufacturer of a mass of selling detail. I had to give exclusive territory in order to get good distributors. 25 years ago, a jobber took on a new line as a favor, and he had to be catered to and everything made just right to suit him. If I were a jobber, I should not want exclusive territory. I should want to have plenty of competition to keep me on my toes. It does a salesman good every once in a while to have a big order taken right from under his nose. When this happens in exclusive territory, the salesman who did not make the sale at once writes an essay on the injustice of the proceeding. But if the territory be not exclusive, then he can only reflect on what a poor salesman he is, which is a very profitable reflection for anyone to make now and again. As we grew larger, we helped our distributors wherever they seemed to need help. We dealt with each distributor as an individual and on the facts. We did not consign our goods, as I never believed in consigned stock. If a distributor were deficient in salesmanship, we did our best to help him overcome this deficiency. We furnished a few signs and placards and some newspaper advertising. In the early days, I established and knew practically all our distributors myself and visited them as often as I could and tried to build them up so that they would eventually be an integral part of our business, except that they would run on their own capital and keep their own profits. The plans worked very well, and they would have continued to work if only these distributors could have seen what I saw in the future of the tire industry. But only a few were willing to stake all they had on selling tires. The automobile industry was not generally looked on as a substantial means of earning a livelihood. It was still something of a game. We tried to organize our distributors. We had them in for conventions, and while many of them were first class, others did not get what we thought they ought to get out of their territory. Therefore, in 1913, we decided gradually to eliminate distributors and set up branches of our own. We did not make any sweeping changes. We simply did not renew the contracts of such distributors as were not up to the mark. Through experience, we had learned that a man of moderate ability and energy could sell a certain minimum volume a year for every car registered in his territory, and we adopted that figure as the minimum which would satisfy us. When a distributor's contract came up for renewal, we judged him on his sales per car and not on his total business. If a man had done $300,000 gross, he might consider himself a pretty clever fellow. But if he had 150,000 cars in his territory, we could not agree with him, for his average per car was too low, and his contract would not be renewed. We did not disturb any distributor who kept up a good selling average per car, and we still have a couple of distributors. It would not be fair to disturb them, because they have always thoroughly worked their territories and kept up their averages. We find the branch method the most satisfactory because now the selling of tires is on a scientific basis, and we must have expert tire men in our employ all over the country, seeing that the proper kind of tires is being sold and that the proper kind of service is being given. No matter how well we may make a tire and how perfectly it may be built for a particular use, we can lose a great deal of reputation on that tire if it be put into a service for which it was not designed. We established about 20 branches and put in branch managers selected from among the distributors or from men whom we thought well of at Akron. We had to throw them in to sink or swim, because we had not in the beginning any organization for close supervision. Eventually, we developed too much supervising, but that I shall tell about later. We paid these branch managers salaries, but not commissions. We have never been fond of the purely commission basis, because many men are short-sighted, and they will neglect service and the steady customer of the future for the immediate customer on whom they can earn a commission. We give to each man the opportunity to progress to a higher salary and to become a large stockholder in the company. In this way, we can weld men into the organization and build up their strength and ours in a fashion which is not possible for an employee's sole interest in his company is what he gets out of it. The branch organizations do not touch manufacturers' sales, and neither do they sell directly to consumers. Their selling is to dealers, and their business it is to see that the dealers are selling to the best advantage. In 1918, we reached our greatest height by establishing a regular magazine on which we prided ourselves mightily. It was not a house organ. It was a general magazine. We paid up to $1,000 to well-known artists for cover designs. We bought short stories and articles from the best writers in the country. The only advertising was on the inside cover pages, where we told about our tires, and on the back cover, which carried the local dealer's advertisements. Otherwise, it was a general magazine and was intended to be received and read as such. It was subtle, but just how subtle, we did not realize until afterward. We called the magazine Milestones, and while it cost us anywhere from 10 to 20 cents a copy to produce, we sold it to dealers for distribution at 5 cents a copy. They simply grabbed for it. Some dealers bought for every car owner in their territory. Within 2 months, we were up to a circulation of 1 million copies. It was the finest bit of advertising we ever put out, for, as I said, it was subtle. So subtle that, as advertising, it was worth to us exactly nothing. The salesmen were charged with selling these dealers' helps. The responsibility was theirs to see that every dealer bought the necessary help to move his tires. I found our salespeople congratulating themselves on the amount of advertising they sold. I began to see salesmen's reports like this. 50 milestones, 1,000 blotters, 500 buttons, 10 tires. Looking through the accounting department, I noticed a new division of clerks that I had never seen before. I asked what they were doing. Billing advertising, came the reply. That set me to thinking. I began to ask myself, are we in the business of selling tires, or are we publishers and sellers of advertising? There was only one answer, so I wiped out milestones and the whole advertising billing department and issued orders that thereafter our salesmen were to sell tires and nothing else. We tried all the frills, but I have not yet told about the truly marvelous sales organization that we erected and which was, until I smashed it, the pride of my heart. All these frills of selling had nothing at all to do with selling. In the beginning, we actually sold tires, but then the great production of automobiles brought a demand for tires exceeding the supply. We thought we were selling to the public. Actually, the public was buying from us in an ever-increasing volume because we were making good tires. Our selling efforts had nothing to do with selling, but they were amusing and kept a lot of people occupied. No end of sales reputations are established by salesmen taking the credit for the public resolutely refusing to be deterred from buying, all of which we found out before any great harm had been done. It was in 1919, when the boom started, that we reached our stride in sales organization. We'd been organizing rather freely whenever we had the time, but when our sales organization was laid out in chart form, it did not look pretty. It lacked the proper number of subdivisions, and it did not have nearly enough managers, so some of our best minds really got down to organizing. I did not know where this organization bug came from, but, like the flu, it hit nearly everyone in the country. I am free to confess what it did to us, for it is over with, and we are immune. I think many other confessions might be added to mine, for I notice that most companies are not so perfectly organized as they were just after the war. The trouble is that nowadays one has to work, and having an absolutely perfect organization on the premises does interfere with work. In 1920, in common with most other manufacturers, we did not have to sell. However, we imagined that we were selling, for the constantly rising prices disturbed our old comparisons. We and everyone else had always figured our product in dollars, and with orders coming in by wire instead of by mail, and with the dollar figures of sales beginning to look like the war debt, it is no wonder that we lost our sense of proportion. And also it is no wonder that we fell in with all the ingenious notions for sales organization. Every change we made in sales methods brought results and proved the new method. We did not know that we would have shown as startling an increase had we abolished our whole sales force, closed all our branches and dealers, and just sent out our tires and freight cars to be thrown off on sidings and taken away by clamoring buyers. Many of us imagined what was happening, but our pride would not let us admit the true condition, and hence the sales department had the leisure to devise fancy trappings for itself. In ordinary times, one has to get along with things far short of the ideal, but in those days we had to have absolute perfection. That was the post-war cry everywhere. I never did catch up with the complete organization of our sales, but it was something in this fashion. First, we had a sales manager, and under him, two assistant sales managers, one for trade and the other for manufacturers' sales. I kept my hand on manufacturers' sales, so it never got really organized, but the trade sales crowd grew amazingly. The first step was to divide the trade sales into East and West, to which later was added South. Each of these divisions was a complete unit at Akron. Each had a sales manager, a truck tire manager, a pneumatic tire manager, and an accessory manager. Each of these managers had an assistant or two, and each division a separate credit, billing, and accounting department. We also had an export department with a complete set of managers. All this was not in the field, but at Akron. It will take me some time to reach the people who were supposed to sell to the dealers. These Akron organizations compared and competed with one another, and I shudder to think of the clerical wages and good white paper that was wasted by them in showing in their several ways how good they were. The branches had been getting along with a branch manager and an office manager. That was all wrong, and so each branch developed a branch manager, a truck tire manager, a pneumatic tire manager, an accessory manager, and a credit manager, all of whom had assistants. Somewhere down the line were the salesmen, who under all this supervision were supposed to sell to the dealers. But even this supervision soon became inadequate, and some genius divided the country into five zones on top of the branches, and each zone had an office managerial staff and a number of divisional men to go about among the branches and see that all was well. In a very short time, our sales force grew to around 1,000. I shall never know what our sales overhead was, for before the organization was quite perfect, we ran into the troubles of 1920, which shall be told of in a later chapter. Then I was more interested in getting down to business than in finding the cost of our indiscretions, and how we did cut. The advertising department had 105 people. We cut the force to a manager, an assistant, and about five clerks and stenographers. We wiped out the whole scheme of divisions and sections, and I became sales manager with the branches directly under me. Their accounting and credit divisions were abolished, and their accounts cleared through the general accounting of the company. We reduced each branch to a sales manager and an office manager, and the sales manager was expected to be out in the field selling. The whole swivel chair squad had the choice of getting out as salesmen or getting out altogether. We went over every part of that sales organization asking, can we get along without this job? In 1921, we cut our sales force 75% over the peak of 1920. What is more important, we started it to selling. The pressure was intense, for salary cuts came for those who remained. Only the men stuck who could stand the gaff, and these were the only men we wanted. Now our sales are on a sensible basis, and we get results. We still make mistakes, and we expect to go on making mistakes as long as we remain human beings. But we are all so close to affairs that a mistake does not get far. If a mistake be made, it is our mistake, and it does not help anyone to put in time hiding it. A fair part of the time of the big, complex organization is spent in steering the effects of mistakes into other departments, and instead of an error being corrected, it is kept in the air. Our present system is not a system at all. It is direct, personal, day-by-day contact. Each month, every branch manager sends me, on one small sheet of paper, a complete picture of the operations of that branch for the preceding month as to sales, collections, and standing of each salesman in sales per car and expense to sales. He also writes me a letter with this report, giving his own version of the operations of his branch for the preceding month and how he hopes to serve his trade better the following month. In this way, I get a complete history of the business in every section of the country. Camping with Edison, Ford, and Burroughs. Among the larger events of my life, I must record the camping trips which I was privileged to take with Thomas A. Edison, Henry Ford, and John Burroughs. We had seven of these trips in 9 years, although two were not strictly camping trips, but rather little journeys from an established headquarters. On four of them, we had John Burroughs. On another came President Harding for a couple of days. On our last trip, which was in 1924, we visited President Coolidge at his old home in New Hampshire. And so this may be a final and the only record of our wanderings. And I want to set down, partly in my own words and partly in the words of others, something about Thomas A. Edison and Henry Ford, for they certainly own the most outstanding sets of brains in the world today. I doubt if any two men ever contributed more to the public welfare than have they, although that may not be as generally appreciated as it ought to be. I've always liked to be with big men, with men whose ideas extend beyond the little things near at hand, and whose vision has no horizon. Both Mr. Edison and Mr. Ford, while giving attention to things near at hand, paint their big thoughts on a far-flung canvas. They have long since passed the point where they give much heed to their personal fortunes. Neither man has the slightest regard for money except for what it will do for humanity, and both have the view that the way to help humanity is to help it to help itself. They are both practical visionaries. They make their dreams come true. They do not talk much about business in the usual fashion. They have nothing to say about details, not because they do not know details, but because their interests are in larger affairs. It is hard to set down what I got from these men in a business way, but then successful business is never conducted on rules. It is conducted on principles put into effect by human energy, by the kind of energy which does not know when it is licked. And for supreme courage and confidence, no one surpasses Mr. Ford. 2 points which Mr. Edison and Mr. Ford dwelt on time and again during our talks about the campfire were: 1. Own your business. 2. Keep plenty of cash in bank. Make the banks work for you. Mr. Edison is a great inventive genius with a wide business experience. He has had a marvelous laboratory experience, but he is impatient of detail that is not connected with his experiments, and really his largest interest is in development. As is well known, Mr. Ford paid 70-odd millions of dollars to buy out his minority stockholders, while Mr. Edison, who has been interested in many companies, has now full ownership and control of all his companies. Both men want to serve the public to the largest degree, and their vision is so long and their courage so high that it would be quite impossible for any group of stockholders to keep pace with them, and especially since neither of them will take the time or the trouble to explain exactly what he is about. Mr. Ford is both a mechanical genius and a business genius. He goes through conventions, through established practices, with a superb surety. He has the genius of reducing a problem to its elements in so simple a fashion that it does not appear to be a problem at all. I can easily see that convincing stockholders of the rightness of this or that course, especially since it might involve the payment of a small dividend instead of a large one, would demand the kind of argument that neither Mr. Ford nor Mr. Edison will make. I doubt if Mr. Ford could have carried out more than a fraction of his plans had his business not been personal with him and his family. For it was the building of the River Rouge plant that brought on the suits which resulted in his buying out all the stockholders. And the River Rouge plant has proved to be the longest single step in the direction of economy that he has ever taken. I agree thoroughly with Mr. Ford that one man must run a business. A business with more than one head is as monstrous as a man with more than one head. This or that business may seem to succeed for a time in the hands of a board of directors or a committee of managers, but it will always be found that either the business is really running on the momentum of the founder, or, as in the 1919 boom, it is running because no one has the strength to stop it, or some one man dominates the directors or committee and is the real manager, whatever his title. Every American business of consequence has been built up by one man staying on the job. The corporate form of organization is only a method of defining the interests of investors. It is not a form of management, and when the stockholders vigorously help in the management, the business cannot prosper. The moment that a company starts paying dividends without regard to future needs, it is as good as finished. If the number of stockholders be large, the dividends have to be high. The stock market actually judges the condition of a company by the dividends it pays. High dividends may be a sign of strength, but more often, they are a sign of heedless management. The position of Mr. Ford with respect to stockholders is certainly sound. It might be argued that with a man of less genius, the plan would not work at all. That is true, but neither would any other plan. A dull man cannot make a success of business just because he has stockholders and directors. There is nothing impersonal about a corporation. It is the most personal thing on earth. No impersonal legal formula for successful corporate management exists. On one point I am certain. The employees ought to have some stock interest, and we have made that compulsory, a condition of employment. And also, I believe that the officers should have their savings in the company they work for. Whenever stock is offered for sale, I try to get the officers of the company in on the purchase. The best results are obtained when a majority of the stockholders are directly involved in the management of the company. Mr. Ford, ever since his business became successful, has always carried a large cash balance. That course he has always urged upon me, and I agree with him that it is the right course. But whether or not it is wise to borrow at times cannot be decided offhand without regard to the nature of the business. An automobile has in it only a small amount of material and a great deal of workmanship. A tire has in it a great deal of material, rubber, compounds, and cotton, and a small amount of workmanship. The rubber, under present conditions, has to come from far overseas. It is 3 months from Singapore. Once I control my sources of rubber, and that is only a few years away, I shall be able to regulate our supplies of rubber according to our business and pay little or no attention to the rubber market. The market fluctuations will be of no consequence to me. But as it is now, we have to buy according to price, although we do not speculate, and this means the tying up of a deal of money. I believe that conservative borrowing makes money for us. The ability to clean up all borrowing once a year is a test of the nature of the borrowing, although not a certain test. There are no certain tests. And out of all the trips, out of all the association with these great men, one precept stands out above all others. It has been the rule of the lives of both Mr. Edison and Mr. Ford. It is the reason why they are great. It is this: go it alone. Do not fail to try because someone has already tried and failed. The war and its financial aftermath turned our business, and most other businesses in the country, upside down. We eventually got on our feet, and in so getting we learned so much that, although I should not like to repeat the experiences, we came out a better and sounder business than before. No business, no matter what its size, can be called safe until it has been forced to learn economy and rigidly to measure values of men and materials. During the 5 years preceding the war, our factory had nearly trebled in size, and we had built a plant, which we call plant number 2, for the making of a single-size tire. With the war, we gave nearly all our output to the government for automobiles and trucks, and our new plant was turned over for the making of army balloons. I served on the Ohio Council of Defense and was a member of the Rubber Division of the War Industries Board. During 1917 and 1918, we made nearly 7 million tires. The war over, we were faced, in common with all other manufacturers, with the task of getting back to what was called normalcy. Akron, it will be remembered, was a boom town during the war. Workmen came in by the tens of thousands to work for the various rubber companies, which were going day and night, and all of us were at our wits' end to find any sort of housing for these men. For instance, we jumped from 7,100 employees in 1916 to 10,500 employees in 1917. It was quite usual for men working nights to share a room with men working in the day. The conditions were extremely bad, but we were helpless for the time being to do much of anything toward making conditions better, for we were concentrated on war work. Also, we had to make new kinds of tires. Before the war, comparatively few automobiles were used for business, and the truck had not established itself as an economical form of transportation. Long hauls by trucks were unknown, excepting as stunts. The war changed all that. The war was fought with trucks, and we had the problem of getting out a truck tire that would stand up under any usage. In 1918, with the railroads clogged with government freight, I started the ship-by-truck movement. We were working in a great many directions and with a large force of highly paid, inefficient floaters. Those were the days when men and boys made so much more money than they had ever had before that they could see no reason for working more than a few days a week. When they had enough money, they quit work and loafed, sure of another job whenever they needed it. We did not stop work immediately after the armistice, for we still had many government orders to fill. But all of us knew that without the government as a customer, we should have to make fewer tires. We saw a depression ahead and a considerable period of adjustment, for the lid had been off prices, wages, and management. We did have some depression, and there was something in the nature of an exodus of workers. We cut down our production early in 1919. Then came the boom, the biggest boom the country has ever known. During 1919, we produced more than 4 million tires and made a profit of more than $9 million. We could not keep up with demand. The railroads under government control were everywhere clogged, and everywhere dealers were paying premiums for delivery. Prices did not matter. Delivery was the thing. We bought tire fabric wherever we could get it, and whenever we could get it. The machinery did not exist to turn out enough fabric for the needs of the tire makers, and we had to bid against each other for fabric. We increased our capitalization from $15 million to $75 million, of which $40 million was preferred. But it was expected that we should have to issue only $10 million. Every one of us felt that the boom was going to keep up, that it was the natural order of things, that we had really passed into a new kind of country, and that we should have to keep pace with what was going on. Everything was moving, and moving fast. The ship-by-truck movement gained tremendously. In 1920, the registration passed the million mark, and most of these trucks were of the ton-and-a-half variety, but others went to 5 tons or more. At first, we made solid tires for all trucks, but then we began the highly important development of pneumatic tires, at first only on the small trucks, but then up to trucks of 3 tons capacity. This required months of intensive experimenting, and we are still investigating and expect to begin research the rest of our lives, for the possibilities of the motor truck have only been touched on. In January of 1920, I rented a house in England, intending to spend the summer there with my family. For it was in 1919-1920 that the presidents and other high officers of companies began to get the idea that they needed rest and recreation, and plenty of it. An executive felt embarrassed if discovered within 1,000 miles of his job. For, of course, a good executive always delegated his duties. Really, there was no managing or selling during those 2 years. But somehow, after I had rented that house, I did not want to leave. Something told me that we were in a boom and that it could not last forever. I took our 800 foremen out to the old farm and told them that, although I was always an optimist and hoped that the business would keep up, yet I had some doubts. This was in May 1920, when business had reached its peak. I advised the foremen not to lose their heads and to be ready to slow down at any time. Then I sailed to Europe. We had borrowed, by that time, $35 million through note brokers, and we had contracted for very large amounts of rubber and fabric. The word had gone around in the tire industry that the man who could get fabric would get the business. We had never made long contracts ahead for fabric, but that year we made several 3-year contracts, and of course at high prices. Everything was at high prices. The sales went on fairly well through June, but in July, when the sales should have been especially good, the stock began to back up on us, and then the officers at home began to cable to me. With sales slowing down, the factories going at full speed, and materials under contract coming in, they could not make ends meet. I did not pay much attention to these cables. I knew that we were in for it anyway, and that it would be a good thing to have a little vacation while I might. I was on my way to Paris for a short trip when I received a cable that I could no longer put aside. It said that sales had absolutely stopped, that the officers had borrowed money everywhere they could and did not know how to hold out longer. I must return at once. I finished my trip and took the next steamer home. The company officers were all on the dock to greet me, and they might have looked more doleful, but I cannot imagine how. We went uptown, had luncheon, and they told me the worst. They owed $43 million, and no bank would lend a penny more. The factory was running, but there were no sales. The commercial paper was falling due, and they had no money to take it up with. And the contract materials were coming in, and they could not pay for them. As a last resort, they had pledged the rubber on what are known as certificates of importation. The case, as they put it, seemed hopeless. They were hopeless. We reached Akron the next morning. It was a Friday morning. Things looked very blue at the office. Having looked about, I said, "I will not tackle this job until Monday." I went down to the old homestead to be alone and to think. And by Saturday, I had finished my thinking. I telephoned the assistant sales manager to have 3 or 4 representative district sales managers, branch managers, and salesmen in my office Monday morning. I wanted to get a first-hand picture of what was going on in the field, for certainly we could not do business without sales. On Monday morning, we had our meeting. All the men there had about the same reasons to give me, which amounted to this. There was no business. The dealers are not only stocked, but also demoralized and will not buy. We talked a while, and then I went to the sales manager and said, "I am going to be sales manager for 30 or 60 days. It may be a little embarrassing for you to be in this department without authority, and I think you had better take a vacation. I'd made up my mind exactly what I was going to do. Ours was not an impossible situation. Situations are only as impossible as one makes them. The sales organization had not been working for a long time. Orders had been handed to them, and they had gotten so soft that now, when real action was needed, they did not have it in them to take action. They saw only closed doors everywhere, and had not the nerve to open them. The situation did not frighten me. It put new life into me. I saw the opportunity to do more business than we had ever done, but first, the inertia of the sales force had to be overcome. I wired for all the branch and district managers to come in. They were a cheerless-looking lot. What I said to them boils down to about this. We're in the business of making and selling tires. The factory here is piled to the roof with unsold tires. All the branches are full of tires, and so are all your dealers. The public has not stopped using tires, but they are not going to buy at present prices. Our tires have to be turned into cash. There is only one way to do that, and that is to make such a big cut in prices that those tires will just have to sell. Therefore, we are reducing all our prices 25%. It is up to you men to show the dealers that it is better business to move their stocks than to hang on to them. We have plenty of tires to sell them, and they will make more money by getting rid of their stocks at a loss and restocking at the new price than they will by holding on to the tires they have in the hope of getting clear on them. Many, I might almost say most of the men, could not understand such a price cut. They saw in it only a lot of trouble with the dealers, for with this one move we were cutting a quarter off the inventory of every dealer, and of course that meant trouble. All of the other tire companies were maintaining prices. After I had made my announcement, the argument started. Some of the men thought that a 10% cut would be enough. Others thought that we might go as high as 15%, but only a few could envision the effects of 25%. I did not tell them that I had been considering 33 1/3%, but I did tell them that a small reduction would not give the smash we had to have, the big dramatic play, for not otherwise could we attract the buying public. These managers had to be convinced, for they had to carry the message out to the country. They had to have the enthusiasm I had for better business. Some would not be convinced and had to be let out. It was no time for half-hearted work. We went to the country with a bang, for that was the way the thing had to go if it were to go at all. We had dealers' meetings all over the country. I went out on the road myself and addressed meetings. Any man who was not willing to give up day and night to putting the sale over just had to get out. We spent money, regardless, in full-page advertisements in the newspapers. We hung big red banners on our dealers' shops. We hung them everywhere, and they had on them our slogan in red, Firestone Tires, 25% discount. It was a fire sale, for the first time in our history. We thrust aside all our dignity and customs. We plastered the country with our slogan. Our competitors fought us for about a month, as I thought they would. Then they trailed after us with cuts. But I only needed that month's start. That start gave us the business. In the months of September and October 1920, we sold $18 million worth of tires. That carried us out of the woods. We took up all the certificates of importation on rubber and reduced our borrowed money account from nearly $44 million to just over $31 million. Reducing the sales prices was only a small part of the work of getting back to normal. I've already described how we cut our office and sales forces. We also reduced our factory force in almost the same proportion, especially the non-productive labor. But we were not entirely out of the financial woods. Our profits for 1921 were less than $1 million. During the depth of the Depression, it was necessary for the banks to carry the big companies in order to preserve a measure of stability. On the 31st day of October, 1924, we did not owe a dollar to any bank. By hammering on economies, by pressing sales and qualities, and by never fooling ourselves as to where we stood, we had wiped out an indebtedness which at one time was thought to be crushing. It was not an easy road we traveled, but we safely got to the end. For 25 years, I have been building a business. I have given it all of my time and thought. I am still giving it all of my time and thought and intend to keep on doing so. I do not know whether I am the slave or the master of that business. But the big thing is that I do not care which, for the job is worth doing as either master or servant. The job is not only worth doing well, but there is a great joy in doing it. All other considerations aside, the very worries and insistent demands on one's mentality and physique are a joy, for they are tests, challenges. Business is not a game. Business is not a science. There are too many unknown and unknowable factors ever to permit it to be a science. Perhaps business is a profession. Of that I am not sure. But rather, I think that business comprehends everything. And that is one of the reasons why I like to be in it. Business leads one into every profession and every walk of life. It is the school of experience. I like people, and business brings one in close contact with a never-ending stream of people. And finally, there is the supreme satisfaction of accomplishment, of planning to do something, and of carrying through those plans against all obstacles to a final accomplishment. Business is made up of opportunities for great sacrifices and great accomplishments. It is the most absorbing occupation on earth. End of Men and Rubber, The Story of Business, by Harvey S. Firestone. Narrated by Merwin Smith. This recording may not be reproduced without permission of the copyright owner, NewsTrack Incorporated.